today we're looking at exploratory data analysis. Today is the 15th. So have you come across exploratory data analysis before? Are you familiar with the term? As a term, I mean, you can kind of guess what it means, but have you come across the phrase exploratory data analysis before? Okay, but in terms of actually using it? Yes, sir. Okay, great. Exploratory data analysis is essentially when you start off with your data set, usually you're told, you're taught, you start off with your data set, and you do certain tests on it. You might find out what the mean is and the standard deviation, get a feel for the data, but essentially you've gone out and collected data and you know what you're going to do with it. You're going to apply a certain number of statistical tests and you probably know what they are. Then you go and do your clinical trial and you know that you're going to get data back and it's going to look a certain way and certain tests are going to be appropriate for it or whatever. But in many cases you start off with your data set and you haven't maybe collected it, maybe it's secondary data, or maybe you have collected it but you're not entirely sure why. You might have research questions, but you might not have testable hypotheses. Exploratory data analysis is a way of working out the shape of the data in lots of different ways before you start doing the nitty-gritty data analysis, the statistical tests or whatever it might be. So it's, in many cases, visual. Exploratory visualization. You get your data and you map it or you chart it and you see what it looks like. And so it could be cartography, it could be multivariate, usually it will be multivariate. And you do it to find out what these patterns are, see what you can see. And you don't often know what it is that you're going to find until you find it. So it's a way of spotting some of these things that then allow you to go on to do your statistical tests, because now you'll know, you'll have a better idea about what you can do with the data. It might simply be generating descriptive statistics, but that's sort of the absolute minimum. Real exploratory data analysis involves using all these things, graphs, maps, tables, multimedia, to play around with the data, essentially, and it's quite a useful thing. It's not very well theorized beyond the fact that you get your data and you play with it until something occurs to you. You have to have a certain level of understanding there, and I'm probably being unfair to say it's under-theorized, but it's not like there's a methodology behind it where you think, right, my first step in my exploratory data analysis is to do this, and then I follow these 10 steps and I know what I'm gonna end up with. It's sort of the opposite of that. You start off at step one, stick it into your bit of geovisualization, if that's the nature of the data, if it's spatial data, and then you see where you go from there. So that's the gist of it. Does that make sense? Okay, so common software for doing exploratory data analysis using using spatial data, GeoDAR, GeoVista, GeoViz, the GeoViz toolkit. And a practical that we had designed for Friday involves using the GeoViz toolkit and playing with a data set that's already there, but obviously there's not going to be that this week, but you're welcome to download it and play with it in your own time, and maybe we'll try and make it up some other time. Often associated with exploratory data analysis is this guy, John Tukey. Have you come across Tukey before? Yeah, you've come across him. So as I've put up on the slide, he invented the term bit, and he claimed to have invented the word software, but there's more doubt about that. Anyway, he was a proponent, not the inventor of exploratory data analysis, but he was very keen on it. You might have come across Tukey in either for inventing the term bit or because he has a few statistical tests named after him. If you want to know about differences between means of different populations and so on, you can do Tukey tests and things like that. So he said this: if we need a short suggestion of what exploratory data analysis is, I would suggest that, one, it is an attitude, and two, a flexibility, and three, some graph paper or transparencies or both. Well, we have computers that we can sort of carry around with us in our pockets now, so it doesn't have to be graph paper, it can be a computer, but you can see what he's driving at there. But that's the absolute minimum. You know, paper and pencil is exploratory data analysis. And he continues, no catalogue of techniques can convey a willingness to look for what can be seen, whether or not anticipated, yet this is at the heart of exploratory data analysis. The graph paper and transparencies are there not as a technique, but rather as a recognition that the picture examining eye is the best finder we have of the wholly unanticipated. So he's drawing on the human brain's, human eye plus brain's ability to spot patterns. We're evolutionarily predisposed to spot patterns and things. That can be problematic because we might see patterns where there are none. But it basically means that if you start drawing, mapping, plotting your data, then things occur to you and you will be able to move forward from there. So it's a state of mind, it's an attitude, as he says, and it's a willingness to see stuff that you might not have expected. So that's the heart of it. It's not a catalogue of techniques. It's just a range of tools, perhaps, plus what goes on in your own head. So you need to be familiar with your data to be able to do your work on it. This is a way of familiarizing yourself with the data. So plot and map your data. I say this to first years upwards. Whatever you've got, plot it, map it, visualize it in some way. So that might be histograms, box plots, scatter plots, parallel coordinates. Have you come across all of these things before? Okay, well, I'll show you what that is then. I'm going to demonstrate this by telling you all about my research. I am interested in spatial variations in 19th century welfare and poverty. So the way that poverty was in different places, what poverty looked like in different places and in the 19th century, and the ways that local authorities dealt with it. So basically I wanted to have a data set that I understood that I could stick into some spatial analysis, and I thought, well, what better than a data set that I know quite well because I generated it myself, so I thought I'd tell you about this, but you need to have a bit of context to understand what's going on. So in 1834, the government decided there was going to be a whole new way of relieving the poor, and it used to be parishes, individual parishes. There were about 15,000 parishes in England and Wales, and they were turned into unions. They were unionized, so a group of parishes became a union, and so you'd have about 20 parishes on average making up a new poor law union. So from 1834, the union was the unit, the local authority unit. About 650 of these poor law unions. And they had two ways of distributing relief. They had workhouses, where people were obliged to live if they were to get enough food and shelter to live. Or they gave cash in the community, or goods in kind in the community, usually bread, and that was outdoor relief. So indoor relief is workhouses, outdoor relief is you turn up to the relieving officer gives you cash and you can go to your own home. And the idea was that the workhouse was a deterrent. It was extremely unpleasant to be in the workhouse, and so you would do anything to avoid it, i.e. you would rely on whatever other means of support you had before you started applying for relief, for poor relief. So you you'd have to be utterly destitute and completely desperate to go into the workhouse. So the idea was that a workhouse, a local authority running a workhouse properly, would have would ultimately reduce the bill, the ratepayers, the people who funded the taxation, paid the taxes, would be better served by having a poor law union that had a strong workhouse, because it would be more of a deterrent. And so they wouldn't be spending all their money indiscriminately on cash to poor people. And local authorities, the poor law unions, had a lot of, there was a lot of variation about how strongly they used the workhouse. Some of them didn't like using the workhouse at all. They thought it was an affront to the dignity of the poor, or they thought it would be too expensive to run a workhouse, because in fact it is much more expensive to house somebody than it is to give them a couple of shillings and tell them to come back in a fortnight. So there were lots of reasons for this variation, but the central government wanted as far as possible for there to be spatial uniformity across England and Wales, certainly within regions. They didn't want it to be possible for a vagrant to travel a certain distance and find themselves in a different poor law union where they were more likely to get cash. So they just wanted people to stay put, and there were lots of legal reasons why they had to stay put, but essentially they didn't want it to be easy to go and claim cash elsewhere. They wanted you to stay where you were and have to deal with the workhouse. So that's essentially what my research is about at the moment. So here's what it looked like inside a workhouse. This is the men's dining hall in Marylebone in about 1900. It's probably a little bit touched up and posed, but that is actually what it looked like. So everybody sitting in eyes front and not talking to their neighbours. It's quite a famous picture. Here are my data sources. I've got parliamentary papers. This one's from 1876. It gives me the year 1850, 1860, 1870, and another 1874. The year ending Lady Day, that's in March. So the year ended in March, in administrative terms, still does in some respect. They've got population according to the newest census, 1851, 61, 71. And they've got the number of paupers for each of these unions. So here we've got Stirminster and Blandford, Blandford Forum. So number of paupers in the workhouse, indoor relief, number of paupers getting outdoor relief, the total, and some ratios that they've calculated, the cost of relief to the poor, and the rate per head, that's the tax base. So this tells me a certain amount of what I need to know. Stick this into the database, it's spatial, obviously. I've got these poor law unions, I know where they are, and now I've got their numbers, and I can plot all this. So I do all this data entry, and I stick all these numbers in, plus many others, and I get my database, and I think, well, what happens next? So one of the things I can do is generate a histogram. So you know what a histogram is, right? So you set the bins, the size of the columns, so you can kind of see it's got a normal-ish shape, it's got a tail, but it's basically normal-ish. This is the percentage of paupers in the workhouse. So take any particular, take a workhouse, the percentage of the paupers who are housed inside the workhouse is rarely more than about 30% at the most. There are a few where it's much higher. There's a couple of extreme examples. I think there's one here and one here. But essentially, you can see where the bulk of activity is happening, and you can see how many there are. So there are 650 in total. So this gives you an idea of what that data looks like. This is a sort of map of how successful central government is in promoting that uniformity. So from here, I might, I can calculate, I can see what the mean is, I can calculate the standard deviation. You know what the mean and the standard deviation is, right? Not really, I've got to ask. Now, are you familiar with this? You know what this means? Yeah, so I've got a scatter plot. This isn't for this data, this is just for this particular thing. So I've got I want to calculate my mean and my standard deviation. So let's start here, come over here. That's the first thing you do. You know, you're always told, what's the mean, what's the standard deviation? That gives you an idea. You plot it on a scatter plot for a very good reason, which is that if you've got your x and your y here, and you can see what the mean is and the standard deviation, the mean of the x is 9 and the mean of the y is 7.5. You've got your standard deviation and you can calculate your Pearson's correlation coefficient. You know what a Pearson correlation, okay. So great, that's a useful set of things to know, okay? We have a problem. All of these scatter plots, in all of them, the mean of x is 9, the mean of y is 7.5. And they all have standard deviations as shown for the x and standard deviation for the y as shown. And the r, the Pearson's correlation coefficient for each of them is 0.82. Have you come across this before? This set of these four? You've seen this before, right? Okay, so this is called Anscombe's quartet. So Anscombe have sort of plotted these. So basically, what does this tell you about the use of the mean and the standard deviation for describing your data? Well, these are accurate. They're accurate numbers. These are true. Well, go on, explain. Yeah. You've got patterns, okay? There are patterns in the data that you don't know just by generating the mean and the standard deviation and, for that matter, the correlation coefficient. You've got, in each of these cases, I mean, the correlation coefficient, tells you that there's a kind of linear relationship. And it's a strong one, 0.82, that's a strong one. Look, there's a really strong linear relationship here. But without that outlier in the bottom left without this outlier, you'd have an even stronger correlation. You've got really good, strong patterns, and here you don't have a linear relationship, top right. You wouldn't know this unless you plotted your data. So the lesson of Anscombe's quartet for me is plot your data. And this is something that people don't always do, and you know too, because you're interested in visualization, right? I don't need to tell you this. But if you plot this, then you get an idea of what the pattern might be. If the first thing you do is get a data set, you don't know it looks like this, you haven't plotted it, but you calculate the mean and the standard deviation and you could be forgiven for thinking that there's a linear relationship. You wouldn't know unless you did your scatter plot. So watch out for those. You're familiar with box plots? That's something else you can do. So I've done my box plots. I've got the percentage in the workhouse, the left-hand axis, the individual boxes show the distributions of the percentages of paupers in the workhouse. So here I can see there's a kind of spatial pattern. I've worked out where and what type of union of local authority I've got. So the London unions, they're all urban, clearly. They've got a nice high proportion of percentage in the workhouse. The northern rural ones and the northern urban ones in 1850 have quite low percentage, but there are many in the northern rural section, so the distribution is quite wide, but the majority are in the central box. You understand what these mean, right? Southern rural, a bit higher, a bit more of a range. A negative percentage. Do you mean the northern rural one? It's actually a zero. There are northern rural unions that don't have a workhouse. That line comes down to here. That's just a little tick that goes on the bottom. But you're right, I should have made that clearer somehow. Maybe I could have had this floating. And that's the L of rural. So it looks like it, but it's not. Same with Wales, except you can see it more clearly because it's an S rather than an L. So these go down to zero. In Wales and in rural areas, there are some workhouses. There are unions that don't have workhouses at all, so they have 0% in the workhouse. So you can see that there's a spatial differentiation here. The box plot. It's not 100% satisfactory, but it's quite a useful way of seeing some differentiation by just plotting a different sort of, just thinking about different types of data, different types of class, different classes, different categories, and see what they look like visually. So I wouldn't have known this if I hadn't done that. Scatter plot, kind of the standard thing that you do. I've got my rural and my urban, the rural in the lighter shade of grey. And this is, I'm comparing the percentage of unions, the percentage of paupers in the workhouse, 1850 for the x-axis, 1871 for the y-axis. And here I can see which of the unions that are sharply increasing, or for that matter sharply decreasing, although there are far fewer of those, their use of the workhouse. And you can see that it's more likely to be urban unions who get more into the workhouse. So there are unions who in 1850 only had 20% of their paupers in the workhouse, and there are these urban ones who now have 40% of their unions in the workhouse. So for each of these, you can see each of these dots is one union. You can see what that is. For the most part, they go as kind of a linear trend. Everybody moves up. Everybody moves up a little bit, mostly. But there are some urban ones who move up quite a lot. Okay, so plot your data. Think about different ways of categorizing it. Okay, so you know what a scatter plot is. Don't need to go into there. You've come across bin scatter plots before. Basically, you make a scatter plot for each of them. This is done through SPSS. For some reason, I've switched the axes here. 1871 for Y, for X, 1850 for Y. This is the spend on the workhouse paupers. So for how much does it cost a union to have a pauper in the workhouse? And so it's a different amount for different ones. And again, I've divided it by different sorts of spatial categories, northern or southern, rural or urban. So you can see where the changes in expenditure are happening. Where does it become cheaper? Where does it become more expensive? So These are just basic things to do for exploratory data analysis. Just think of all the different charts you can make and make them. You know, usually you're told not to have a scattergun approach to data analysis. But I think that's not true when it comes to the visualizations. I think it's perfectly reasonable to make graphs of every variable just to see if there's a relationship. If it looks like there's a relationship, there might be underlying reasons why it's not causative, and you can always work out something in a bit more detail about what's going on there, but it's a very good hint that there might be something to look at anyway. Parallel coordinates, you were saying you
haven't seen parallel coordinates before. Well, there's a good reason for that. It can be incredibly ugly and unwieldy. What we have here are, in a normal chart, you would have an x-axis and a y-axis. You'd have two axes. If you want to have three axes, well, you can do it by having a z, or you can have it by just having them all in parallel. And you just draw a line from where they are from one to the other. So I've differentiated rural and urban. I've got two, and I've got three axes for each. The number in the workhouse, the spend per inmate, and the percentage in the workhouse. And there's no particular reason why I've done that. And all these really show is that there are far more rural unions than there are urban unions. So all you get from this is a kind of, what's the mass of it? But parallel coordinates is something that's quite useful for multivariate analysis. So you sort of see that there's a different shape in some respects. The spend per inmate tends to be lower. Or rather, there are a few higher spend per inmates among the rural unions, but you'd expect that because there are more of them, and really it's only a handful. I don't think this tells you an awful lot. It can do, if you have a smaller data set, perhaps. You get a different color for each of your unions. A good thing to do is to, in some, you can click on these individual things and you can find out what they are. So I've just chosen some key indicators and stuck them in. Interesting look at it. But it can be a great big mess, as you can see.
So here we have
GeoDAR. So here are my data. For that, GeoDAR is an exploratory data analysis tool. And I've got a few different maps that I've made, two different maps in this case, and parallel coordinate plots, and a window that has a report of the regression that I've run. It's an ordinary least squares regression. I don't think you can do geographic weighted regression on this, but you could probably plug it in somehow, because I think the source code, I think it's open. I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that you can do this sort of thing in geographic weighted regression as well. Anyway, OLS tells me, what did I discover in this? Nothing particularly interesting. Here's my parallel coordinate plot. I've got the indoor expenditure per pauper, so the spend per indoor pauper, the percentage in the workhouse, the rateable value per pauper, so that's the tax base per pauper, and you can see that there are some patterns, but there are some extreme outliers as well. Here I've got the price of bread in the top right corner. This is so it can do a simple choropleth. You basically tell it to look at the shapefile, and it's got the DBF attached to it. In the same way that Esri or QGIS would do it. So here you can just simply do a standard deviation plot and it will do a choropleth standard deviation. So here you can see where is it expensive to buy bread and where is it cheaper to buy bread. So you can see there's a great big north-south divide in the price of bread. Quite a useful thing to know, which tells you something about why paupers are in particular places. And here you have a cartogram. If you want to make a cartogram, a quick and dirty way of doing a cartogram is to do it in GeoDAR. Much nicer than the Dorlingogram thing that you plug in that you get, the add-in that you get for Esri, for ArcGIS. This is quite nice. So the size of the bubble, every union becomes a bubble, obviously. The size of the bubble is based on the population density. So if this were just like here, you can see in the top one, London is tiny, all of these unions are tiny because they're densely populated, so you just get a better view of that. So this was like the thing we were talking about in the practical. You just make it a bit bigger. So you can see that, you know, in the southeast of England, London especially looks much bulkier than the rest. And then you colour it in according to whatever it is that you want it to be coloured in, the indoor percentage. So the percentage of paupers in the workhouse is the colour. So here you can see London has got many, central London has got lots of unions with high workhouse use, with an outer ring of unions who have low workhouse use. And here you can see Wales hardly uses the workhouse, Yorkshire and Lancashire hardly use the workhouse. Of course, the problems with these are you can't be entirely sure which one is which just by looking at them. You don't know exactly how it's reorganised them, but it's quite a handy thing to do. It looks nice, I suppose, in certain circumstances. If you can get this to look nice, it can be quite a useful thing. So that's how Geodar works. Just look at that one in more detail. That's the same one as I was talking about. So you can see it's got bigger. Yeah, you can see more clearly. What do you think? Good thing to do? Bit gimmicky? Yeah. Quite useful way of looking at two variables at once. But you don't really want to have a variable. I think population density is an okay variable to have for the size. For the size of the blobs. Because population density is a kind of, it's not static, but it's a kind of, it's a more permanent looking kind of thing. It's, you know, I think the colour is quite a good thing to do for the variable of interest, and the size thing is quite a good thing to do for something about the fundamental nature of the unit that you're looking at. Does that make sense? See what I mean? So if it was swapped, see, your eye is drawn in two different ways. Your eye is drawn to the colours, but also to the size. You know, you can't help but look at the southeast of England, and within that, you can't help but look at the dark coloured ones. But if I wanted to make it so that if you want to be more interested in the rural ones, then you would kind of keep it as it was, I suppose, because you can see much better, you know, what the mass of the rural unions is doing, and that's basically almost all of them. It's just you don't get to see London. So here you could have London as a pullout. That's the classic way of doing it. But this is quite good for, it's quite good for conference presentations, but it wouldn't necessarily end up in an academic paper. But nonetheless, it can be quite a handy thing to do. This is something else that Geodar does. Have you seen these before? Sort of map. I think they call it a conditional map. And if you've ever struggled with generating in batch multiple maps of the same thing, this is quite a handy way of doing it. It's amazing that Geodar does it like that, whereas ArcMap would have to think about it for a year. What you have is percentage of paupers in the workhouse. 1850 on the x-axis, 1870 on the y-axis. And so I split them into low, medium, and high, so you get three. And I've put the breaks in, 10.1, 15.4 on the x-axis, 8.3, 14.2, sorry, on the x-axis, the previous on the y-axis. And they're coloured in, they're coloured in rural and urban. So the urban ones are the dark and the rural are the white, which of course you can't see on this. But it looks better when it's printed. So where there is either white or black, they fall into that category. Low, for instance, or low medium, or low high. So the ones that were high in 1850 but were low in 1871, that's basically one in London and a handful outside. The majority go up the middle. But occasionally you get some that were low in 1850 and high in 1870, and those tend to be the ones in the northeast of England. So this one told me that although there were many that just did the same thing, those that were low stayed low, those that were high stayed high, those that were medium stayed medium, where there were big changes from low in 1850 to high in 1870, they tended to be these urban ones and a scattering of urban ones all over the other part, all over the south of England as well. So that's quite a handy thing to do. Well, they were medium and then they became high. So they went from a medium to a high, they're even more. So almost all of the urban in northeast are accounted for by, you know, they fall into a sharp riser category. Do you see what this is showing? I shouldn't need to be. To be a successful visualization, it shouldn't require this much explanation, but if you're unfamiliar with the data, then I guess I can be forgiven. But I hope I can be forgiven. But this is quite a useful way of doing it. So all the greyed out area is basically where there is nothing is happening. It just means that it's shown elsewhere on a different map. So that's something that you can do with GeoDar. Now, the great thing about geovisualization tools, as they are at the moment, is this thing called brushing. And this is a screenshot from the GeoViz toolkit. But what you do with brushing is, let's say you've got, in the bottom, you've got your core path. You highlight one of the units. It will highlight that in all of the other windows. So you've got several windows. They're all showing the same data, but they're showing different things about them. So you've got your star plots, for instance. This one is a star plot map, so it's that data plus this on top equals that, yeah? You've also got an animator, so you click on start and it will start from the lowest to the highest and it will just highlight them all in turn and you set how fast it does it. So when you use your mouse just to click on one of these things, it will bring up the relevant plot from a different window. So you can, there are lots of different things you can do, lots of different windows you can have open. So this ability is called brushing. As you move your mouse over it, or as you click on it, it will select that in the other windows. It's worth worrying about ways of understanding space when you're dealing with this. Exploratory data analysis, you know, when you're using spatial units, it's very easy to think, well, it's a boundary, so it must be, you know, there's something of interest happening in here. I probably don't need to go into too much detail about this, but just bear in mind that there are all sorts of different ways of understanding the way that space works that aren't necessarily to do with formal boundaries, administrative units. So although I'm showing my administrative units from the 19th century, there are lots of similarities and differences that transcend or go beyond or flow between or don't apply to those boundaries. So it can fool you, I think, in some respects. This isn't fundamental to exploratory data analysis, but more just in terms of the way that you look at regional spaces anyway. So we tend to think about different ways of understanding regional space. It might be formal. A formal region, it might have, so it would be an attribute similarity, so the region where certain things happen, the region where a certain phenomenon is common. So that might be the region of low employment, whatever that means. So all these areas of low employment might be a formal region. You can have a functional region, so that might be the area where the newspaper delivery node delivers newspapers to, a distribution center. That will have a functional nodal region. Or it might be a combination of the two, so the labor market in Southeast England, you know, it's a Southeast England, that's a kind of administrative or formal region, or it might plus the labour market. So there will be different ways that these overlay. As usual, you have to think about spatial units and scales and measurement units, just with anything else. But I thought I'd stick that up there anyway. Is that useful? Does that make sense? These are things you think about anyway, right? Okay. Cool. So when you're doing your exploratory data analysis, your visualizations, just with any other data set, you think about what are you going to show, what aren't you going to show, how are you going to show them? What kinds of plots and maps can you do? Well, there's a whole range available in these software kits. Some of them are appropriate to your data and some of them aren't. So you just think about what's useful. And how are you going to group your data? You're not exempt from having to think analytically about your data set, how you're going to organize it and aggregate it and approach doing queries or lookups on it just because it's exploratory. You still have to do that, because if you don't, you can generate utter nonsense exploratory data analysis isn't a sort of free-for-all, plot everything and see what sticks. You still have to think about how you're categorizing, classing, aggregating, and sort of generalizing. Stephen Few has come up with some requirements for geospatial, in particular EDA, exploratory data analysis. He reckons to be genuinely useful, it must have seamless data interaction. So you click on things, brushing, that sort of thing, and things work with each other. Rich data comparison, define rich, that's up to you. Multifaceted views, I guess that's another way of, it's another way of saying the previous two. Perhaps integrated statistical calculations, so it's not just for visualization, there is some stats behind it as well. And live data access and integration, so it's got to be flexible and preferably extensible, and you should be able to work quickly. But a lot of these things are in alpha or beta, and they crash quite regularly and can freeze up your computer. So there's a trade-off between quickly written code and usability. So bear that in mind when you're playing with these. Anyway, there's a link to GeoVis Toolkit. You are welcome to download it, install it on your computer, and see what happens. You should be able to get it through the service store, I think, but if not, then get it through.